Good morning, America. Good evening, South Africa, Pakistan, and India. This is your friend, Dr. Faz, with a new episode of Live with Dr. Faz. Today, we have an opportunity to learn from a leader who teaches how to lead. She's from South Africa. She's been an entrepreneur for the last 20 years with the multinational companies, and also she has been awarded recently by the Mrs. Mandela as an emerging real leadership trainer and coach there in South Africa, and she is an emerging leader there. And it's an honor for me to invite her here. So please help me welcome to get on the stage my friend, Miss Aarti Moore. Thank you, Aarti.
Salam.
And it's my pleasure to have you on my show. Thanks for joining us.
That's awesome. And good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everybody wherever you are in the world. It's exciting to be with all of you on a Friday afternoon or evening, or morning for that matter. And thank you so much for this opportunity.
It's my pleasure. Okay, so let's start from informally first. How the things are in South Africa with the COVID-19?
There's mixed emotions about it because, as you know, with the lockdown of this nature, there's a lot of repercussions. A lot of people are downsizing, and it's affected a lot of people on a massive scale, from unemployment. And I think one of the worst parts is because the people in the poor areas did not have access to much. They didn't have access to transportation that was shut down. They didn't have access to even proper governance in sending out food parcels to communities that are quite massive. I mean, there's nearly 56 million odd people in this country. Mm. And with the shutdown of this nature, it's affected a lot of people in that way. And I think starvation is the biggest key. Mm-hmm. People are wanting to go back to jobs that are non-existent at the moment. Many people did not have access to technology in the way that we all have to continue business, and they didn't have the skills to do it. So I think it's brilliant in a way because it's opened up everybody's eyes to where we need to grow, where there's opportunity for improvement, and what we could do differently for the areas that were most affected, but also where, as businesses and companies, we could innovate and do things to help uplift people more than just relying on the after effects. It's people are being innovative. Even our president has made amazing strides, amazing decisions. And I think he's actually gained a lot more affection from people because of the decisions he's made.
That's awesome. Yeah. So tell me a little bit about, like, you have a strong career in the past with the multinational companies, and you were very successful. So how did you make this transition from that corporate world to an entrepreneur world?
Okay, that's an easy one. I've never been employed by anybody. Mm-hmm. Since I was 18. Uh-huh. I never worked for anybody. I've never earned a salary from a corporate. Uh-huh. I went straight into business when I was 19, and I took a small business, a training company, and I changed it around. And my journey as an entrepreneur began when I was 19. And I took that company to international level with changing and adjusting, learning and developing, creating, and just having a thirst and knowledge to learn more. And what I did was I connected with a lot of people of different cultures, different backgrounds. I think the best part was knowing the impact that older, more experienced people had. And what I did was I made it my duty. And in my quest to understand more, I questioned a lot. So the transition was from not understanding business to realizing the global impact of global best practices, the impact of strategic planning, how companies merge, where the disconnect is, where the challenges are, how they can build relationships, how they can communicate more effectively. And more importantly, the art of connecting at an emotional level, because I saw working with a lot of companies. So my journey allowed me to connect with boards of directors and management teams around the world, Fortune 500 companies to small businesses and single entrepreneur-owned businesses. And I noticed the discrepancies and the lack of tools and skills in the one area, and where there was an abundance of skills and tools in the corporate environments that could have been utilized more effectively. And what I did was I looked for how we could bridge that gap in terms of connecting people so that they could share their knowledge and wisdom in a more effective way.
Yeah, but can I ask you now this question, because you are an entrepreneur from the very beginning. So was it an inheritance, or how did you come up with that idea that I'm not going to work for anybody else?
Oh, okay. So I'm born in South Africa. I'm fourth generation of Indian parents. So I think it's ingrained in the Indian culture to persevere knowledge, wisdom, education, reading a lot. And I feel that because my parents owned a restaurant when we were very young, they left us in charge of the restaurants from the age of 13. Mm-hmm. We were only in that environment for a few years, but it taught me hospitality. It taught me about the ability to care for people and give them as much as we could, respect and honor people regardless of what culture they came from, and how to add value to people so that you always made them feel loved and cared for when they walked into our restaurant. So everybody became family. So it was about building deeper relationships. And I was intrigued by that. So I actually studied a year of business marketing and management and business law. And my parents expected me to become a lawyer, and I escaped because I was intrigued by business and the excitement behind it and creating ideas and taking it to completion. For me, that is the most exciting part.
Yeah. So were you like introverted or extroverted by nature?
Very introverted.
Yeah.
I still am to a massive point, even in my personal life. I've been escaping talking. And I always remained in the background, even in business. And even though we've got an international training company, I would always put other people first and build the stage for them to excel and to shine. I would help them, guide them, support them, and do every single thing that made them feel confident when they stood up. So it's only been in the last 5 years that I've embraced the journey of using my voice to effectively empower and influence people differently, because my journey took me on a level where I believed that I could have more impact to support people to achieve their dreams and their hopes and where they're heading in life, because I could see it. I just was not connecting with them in that way on a big scale. I was doing it successfully one-on-one, small groups. But a lot of people kept asking me to do talks. And I think when I was 23 was my first public speech, and that was to 7,000 people.
Wow.
And I did not know what I was going to talk about. I did not know what were the important skills that a speaker needed. And I know that you're a Toastmaster. And so you understand the nuances of when you're on stage and your stage presence and all of that. I didn't have any of those skills or abilities. I just knew that people wanted me to talk about something that was very important to me. And that was, and at that point, I was hugely into getting people to see how they can connect with each other, how they can remove barriers of racism and gender issues and being and all of the injustice that came from people putting each other down across culture, religion, language barriers, and how they used their excuses in this country, that racism was the excuse for their inability to be productive or their reasons for being lazy or anything that people did not want to accept, they always brought it back to the race card. And I felt that my message at that time was to say to people, if you're a human being, you have the ability to stand up and step up and do everything to the best of your ability, because that is common sense. But I couldn't do that just by sitting back. And I knew that was a burning thing within me. So I built the business and surrounded myself with a whole lot of people and upskilled them to pass on the message. And it's only in the last 5 years that I've actually embraced that journey of actually speaking up myself and getting onto interviews and writing my book and also speaking a lot more on many platforms around the world.
So now I have another question with that answer, that as far as you're doing whatever you have a passion for, but was it a passion for entrepreneurship or was it a passion for leadership? It's two different things.
Entrepreneurship.
Okay.
It was entrepreneurship. I still love it.
Yeah. So why? That's why you chose to be a trainer, or like your company is training company, like you said, internationally, a leadership training and whatever you do. So my point is, why that's the only entrepreneurship business you picked?
No, actually, the entrepreneurship began with the company that I was able to take and remold and readjust and rebrand. And that journey allowed me to connect with incredible people. Because I feel that with entrepreneurship, a lot of entrepreneurs around the world will bypass salaried people in corporate environments on a massive level because their development is different. So where corporates would have a focused direction in the development, an entrepreneur needs to learn, adjust, create, develop continuously, because they have to know all aspects of a business. And I just, my journey, I got to meet Jim Rowan. I got to meet quite a number of inspirational authors around the world. Jeanette Foss, Gordon Dryden, Colin Rose, quite a number of people who had an impact on me. And as I got to understand their material, I could see the relevance of connecting with thought leaders and people of influence and bring it into my life. But there was always something missing, and that was the leadership side, because I saw the impact of how our diversity and inclusion company was impacting people. But I wanted something a little bit more that I could add value to the directors and the management teams I was working with. So I embarked on a journey of getting to know the John Maxwell team 6 years ago. And that's where the leadership stuff started. And what was stunning about it is I actually embarked on the journey just for my own personal self-development. And that was for me to push myself to see how I can grow into becoming a person of influence. And for me, that meant finding my voice, articulating myself more clearly, being more focused on a vision of where I'm heading, and being very careful and thoughtful about the words that I use and why I'm using it and how I will impact other people. And based on that journey, I met my partner, Jan Roberts, at the international program that was 6 years ago. And he spoke to me about values and it intrigued me. And I thought, okay, that resonates with me. Human behavioral values, understanding diversity, inclusion, respecting and honoring people. And then how do we use this to lead and influence others so that they are so inspired, they feel that it is easy to adjust their behavior or actions in their everyday lives, that they don't have to be learned people. You don't need an education of high proportions for this. You just need common sense and the ability to connect meaningfully with a human being. And I felt that this journey is going to allow me to create an impact, where I then launched two specific movements based on it. It's Impact a Country. So I created my vision of taking entrepreneurship and leadership to a bigger scale of how can we impact entire countries using values, using compassion. And then even more than that, I found that there's a lot of disconnect between men and women with the gender-based violence and the gender issues. So I launched a more proactive side of it, which was Ladies and Gentlemen Unite, collaborating for each other's success. Because I strongly believe that not all men are abusers and not all women are abused. Mm-hmm. So we need to change the perspective, and we need to encourage and respect men as much as we respect women. And so that if we could collaborate in that way, it would allow me to influence the thinking of people. And when everybody says there needs to be a mindset change, nobody tells you how, and nobody gives you tools of what to do in your everyday environment. So that was my challenge to myself. And to do that, I needed to step up and move into the leadership roles. And to do that, I've been studying all of the amazing leadership gurus and actually just testing. What more can I do? How can I serve people better? And how can I add value at a more intentional level?
But my question is, there are so many thought leaders around nowadays, and great leaders are there. Why John Maxwell?
You know, that was fascinating for me because I'd never heard of him before. It just happened that I received an email, and it was a mini video. It was a Minute with Maxwell video, and something that he said resonated with me. It spoke about integrity and it spoke about impact. And just those words pushed me to actually embark on that journey of getting to know the John Maxwell program and to learn more about how I can use the tools to impact people better. And it's been a fascinating journey because the system gives you the tools and the know-how, but more than that, the support to guide you on your road to success. Now, I loved that because it is an ongoing journey, but it is a continuous journey of growth. So I think that resonated a lot with me.
So do you think after joining the John Maxwell, it did change a little bit in your, anything in your specifically entrepreneurship strategy and your personal life? Is there any change in that?
It changed everything.
It changed everything. Yeah.
It changed my personal life. It changed business life. It changed family life. I actually moved. I left my hometown and my entire family. And I actually moved to another city in our country. So I was born and brought up in Durban. And being a community-based family, you know, we've got hundreds of family, cousins, aunties, uncles, everybody. And it's because of the John Maxwell team. I actually saw the benefits and the privileges of being a part of the team. And with Ian Roberts by my side, we actually, he left his country and he joined me. And together we built our Key Leadership Institute company based on the John Maxwell programs and the values-based leadership program. And within the last 6 years, we focused using only those two areas to impact people in orphanages, squatter camps, informal areas, poor areas, abused men and women programs. We did this with schools, universities, top levels of government, corporate. That is totally different to what I'd been doing for 18 years before that. And I just found the impact of the support structure that the John Maxwell team gave to me, gave me the ability, and as well as Ian being by my side, gave me the ability to be able to take the next steps forward, to step into where I deserve to be as a person of influence. It's still an ongoing journey.
Yes, of course.
So, but it's an exciting one.
Yeah. So now let's take this easy part aside. Let's come to the difficult
easy part. That is easy.
Yeah, that was easy because it was an icebreaker. So let's talk about, because the passion which you have, and also myself, I am very interested in that too, the leadership. So you have a more focus on compassionate leader of influence to create, how to create them. So first of all, my question is, leadership and influence go side by side. I mean, they are together. So what do you think? Give me a one-liner for the leadership.
Oh, I have a brilliant one about leadership and influence. I always say to people, never come down to somebody else's level, but bring them up to yours. But if you are not evolving and adjusting who you are as a person of influence, what are you bringing them up to? Mm-hmm. Because as leaders, whatever they do, whatever they say, they're influencing people to change a behavior or to follow their behavior and their actions. Mm-hmm. The scary part is if they're not cognizant of every single thing that they're saying and doing, people watch what they're doing and they follow the actions of the person more than the words. Mm-hmm. So we've got to be very careful. So when we look at that, I would say that influence is a privilege. And it is something that we must never, ever take for granted. Mm-hmm. And that humility is a massive part of influence and leading.
Okay, so as an expert of leadership and as a trainer and as a mentor, as a coach, that's what you do for your passion. Give me a couple tips for people who are watching us and who are going to watch later on too. What do best practices any leadership needs, any leader has to have? So what tips, even more if it's up to you.
Oh, I love your question. You are right. Hey, you're giving me all the hard questions now. Okay. Firstly, I would say that I am not an expert. What I have done, though, is embarked on a journey of understanding leadership. Mm. And I found that there's a lot of flaws in the books and in the training when it comes to leadership training. Because everybody talks about being a strategic, being a strategist, how to push your people, how to engage and manage them. My belief that when it comes to leadership, you don't manage people. What you do is you guide and you support them and you look at the areas where they are battling and you upskill them because of your experience. Mm-hmm. As a leader. You've got to continuously develop yourself because you have got the full responsibility of other people's lives in your hands. Now, if you don't begin by understanding that, that is the biggest mistake in leadership that many people do not realize. The impact of the decisions they make without being inclusive is devastating to the entire impact of the company. What I have learned in being in South Africa is that there are African principles of leadership that is stunning that you don't find in the normal Western principles of business. Now, the simplicity is inclusive leadership, mm-hmm. where you include everybody's voices, you ask the question, and you listen carefully. Now, I'm not saying that as a leader, you've got to follow blindly. I'm saying listen carefully and with intent. Now, when you listen to your people and they feel heard and they feel seen, mm-hmm. then you make them feel valued as human beings in your organization, and that is how you build loyalty. Mm-hmm. And when you make them feel included before you make a decision, what you're doing is you're saying, you are important to me as a person, as mm-hmm. a human being. And so inclusive leadership means that you get your people to become solution focused and make them come up with all of the ideas. And then as a leader, you look at all of the ideas and strategically use the one that will best impact your company, your bottom line, the vision where they're heading, the journey they're going into. That is all amazing in terms of being an inclusive leader. Another one that I found when I said a good leader, an excellent leader, a compassionate leader makes people feel seen. What that means is, and from my perspective, is that anybody who is leading teams of people need to connect at a level where a person does not feel like it's my age or it's because of my culture or my religion or it's because of my gender, I'm not good enough. A good leader will connect with each person meaningfully and actually engage with them. ask them, where are you? What is your vision? Where are you heading in life? Mm-hmm. Where do you feel you need to grow? And when good leaders ask great questions, and that's a John Maxwell book as well, mm-hmm. Good Leaders Ask Great Questions, it leads them to the point where they're engaging in a meaningful way for people to feel mm-hmm. like they can approach the leader and hold him or her accountable and say to their leader, you know, the decision you made the other day was good, but could be better. Here are the reasons. So that is what encourages accountability, approachability, humility. And, you know, people are always saying that good leaders are vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Now, nobody's asking them to cry in front of people. Yeah. Is it not saying that you need to open up your private life to everybody?
Mm-hmm.
As leaders, you must have balance and boundaries. However, your ability to be vulnerable means that you've been respectful and respect people so much that they feel comfortable to speak to you and say, you asked us to do mm-hmm. this and this is the deadline. I don't quite understand what needs to be done. Can you help me? That means they're approachable. It means in their vulnerability as a leader, they've mm-hmm. opened themselves up to compassionate or empathetic conversations mm-hmm. where they realize that where the people realize mm-hmm. that the leader is not going to hold a grudge or become aggressive, or there's repercussions afterwards. And I find that if you just use those two things, the third one would be to respect, honor, and value people as human beings,
mm-hmm.
which means that when you interact as a leader with any person, you should be the kind of person mm-hmm. that can make them feel brilliant for who they are, regardless mm-hmm. of their sexual orientation, their age, their gender, their religion, their cultural background. What you're doing is you're interacting on a level of openness, kindness, and thoughtfulness. And that's where a compassionate leader of influence mm-hmm. can actually help people to grow to the next levels.
Mm-hmm.
And that will result retention of talent. It'll stop people from leaving the organization. Because you hear a lot of people saying that people leave they leave people, they don't leave organizations.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're losing people, you need to take a step back and have a lot of reflection
mm-hmm.
and look at where you as a leader and what development do you need differently? Is it social intelligence, emotional intelligence? Is it love intelligence? Are mm-hmm. you the type of person who is so focused on getting the job done that mm-hmm. you forgot about the feelings of the people you're impacting?
Awesome. I mean, in other words, I can say to summarize it, that leader, they don't manage people, they develop people, obviously, mm-hmm. number one. But I have a personal question right now.
Yes.
You know Juan Roberts, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
I do.
Does he know telepathy? Because he's writing all the time, which I was thinking exactly from your answer. So he has a telepathy, some skill. All right, Juan.
He's here with me.
Yeah. Yeah. So no. Awesome. I mean,
he's actually downstairs. He's here with me.
No, but I'm just saying. I mean, he's reading my mind exactly, which coming in my mind, and I'm consistently watching this that. He is writing the same thing which I was thinking. Anyway,
he's brilliant. He's amazing.
He's a leader. I mean, again,
he's an amazing man.
Yes, and again, we have a pretty much, same philosophy about life. Most of us. That's why we are in this industry and we are doing whatever we do. So awesome. So tell me about. I mean, now we did talk about leadership. Tell me. Mm-hmm. How to be that leadership should be converted or consist of compassion. What it needs a little bit more than an average leader, or what does it need to be a compassionate leader?
I think one of the that's an excellent question. I feel that wherever a person is right now,
mm-hmm.
remove the words of I'm a good leader, I'm an average leader, I'm an excellent leader.
Mm-hmm.
Just remove all of the words and change the perspective. Understand that as a human being, you have the ability
mm-hmm.
to influence people based on your words, your actions, and your behaviors. Mm-hmm. And when you get to that point as a person of influence, mm-hmm. you realize that you can adjust and you can do things differently. Mm-hmm. And when you get to that realization, you have a heightened sense of awareness and a different consciousness, which mm-hmm. means that you now have the ability to ask yourself good questions. Mm-hmm. Christian Simpson from the John Maxwell team actually asks this. He says this in a very succinct way. Mm-hmm. He says quality questions mm-hmm. guides you to create quality actions that gives you quality results in your life.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
So if you are a person who believes you're an average leader, no, you, that is what you believe of yourself in that mm-hmm. moment. Mm-hmm. And once you have that thought, you now have the ability to change it. Always say to people, you're not a tree, you can mm-hmm. move. So once you've had that thought, move to the next level, mm-hmm. change direction. Choose a different part of your journey that's going to take you to the next levels of improvement or greatness. You're not limited by a description attached to your name.
So, in other words, I mean, how much empathy plays a role as a compassionate leadership? Empathy is really important when you're leading those people as a compassionate mm-hmm. leader. How much role is that?
I think it is an inherent part of it, but it's not the entirety of it. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of people can sit and empathize, but then not become decisive. Now, mm-hmm. as a leader of influence, a compassionate mm-hmm. leader of influence, you need to understand that there should always be boundaries as well. So as much as you understand a person's journey and mm-hmm. you can empathize with where they're at in their lives, mm-hmm. what you need to do is be very strategic in how you help them to grow. Now, what I have realized in life with working with thousands of people is that some people just refuse to grow, and that is their personal choice. Mm-hmm. And so as much as you empathize with where they're at, as a leader, it is not your prerogative to drag them along. It is not your prerogative to push them until they mm-hmm. develop. What you need to do is be empathetic in your decisions as well, to realize that some people will grow and there are some people you will need to let go, and you need to do that guilt-free. And that is a powerful part of the compassionate leader of influence. You will make decisions. It might upset some people, mm-hmm. but when their time is right, they will find the right environment for them to grow.
Just for the viewers' sake, and personally, I would like to know that. Give like few name of those leaders which you feel like they were really compassionate.
For me, it's personal people that I've interacted with. Mm-hmm. There have been CEOs that I've interacted with in this country. Now, a lot of people would name somebody from books. And people from around the world who are multimillionaires and thought leaders. Mm. No, for me, it's the people here in this environment. It is leaders in the communities that I've sat in the dirt with. There are people who've got hundreds of community members who follow them. Mm. And I've sat at their feet and listened to them. Mm. It is my grandmother mm-hmm. who taught me forgiveness and understanding and respect. Is an everyday thing, it's an intentional thing, and it is it's non-negotiable. Mm-hmm. So the greatest leaders are the people that surround us mm-hmm. in our everyday lives, in our friends, in our families that we don't even acknowledge. Mm-hmm. It's in my mom who continuously pushed through all adversity to mm-hmm. be where she was as mm-hmm. a single mom. It's Jan. In his ability to grow and in his everyday actions that I'm inspired on a daily level. Mm-hmm. It is people like Mahatma Gandhi, because he showed that compassion and caring for people came in nonviolence, satyagraha. Mm-hmm. He showed that in his actions and through his words and his influence that we could resolve many issues, and even right now, current issues can be addressed if we found our voices and embraced our stories mm-hmm. and stood our ground mm-hmm. and stepped up with respect mm-hmm. and honoring the human being for who they are, and we could actually reduce quite a lot of the issues that we have mm-hmm. in our lives. So, I mean, there are amazing everyday people mm-hmm. who have inspired and guided me in every way. And I think one of the people that stands out for me a lot is Simon Sinek.
Mm-hmm.
So I know for a lot of viewers, they'd be looking for people that stand out. Brené Brown's talk has stood out for me.
Mm-hmm.
And it inspired me to grow differently. Simon Sinek's talk or mm-hmm. some of his talks in his book inspired me to grow. But the majority of the leaders that I have found embodied compassion were community people, community-based leaders, mm-hmm. and people who really understood how to engage meaningfully with each other.
Awesome. Yeah, so that's a good... But if somebody would like to be a leader, like I'm talking about, people always, they have a dream to become a leader and all that. What would you suggest? What the first couple foundational qualities they should develop in themselves? It's like a foundation.
Excellent question again. For me, I feel that being intentional is a powerful tool to begin with. You take out a journal,
mm-hmm.
buy yourself a journal, and write down first why you want to lead, who mm-hmm. you want to lead, what is your message,
mm-hmm.
what is the impact that you will achieve from leading.
Mm-hmm.
And when you understand those areas, you then grow your vision to the how and the what, and all of those areas fall and fit into place.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to lead women, mm-hmm. it does not make sense for you to go and study strategic planning
mm-hmm.
because you're not going to lead companies in that way. What you want to do is then focus in on development in terms of leadership from that perspective, because when you look at your audience or the people you want to interact with, it makes a massive difference. You want to lead and inspire and guide and support young people, young leaders, young children, then you need to be developing those areas. And then the programs, the courses, the people of influence, those areas will become more relevant to you. And you'll find that when you tune in to your intentions of why mm-hmm. you want to lead, you will attract the right people into your sphere of influence. People will guide and support you. And then your next step in your house is to find out how to do it.
Yeah, but people, I mean, I go all the time, like in different these events and as a speaker and as a coach. And I get this question all the time, and hopefully you do the same thing, that people don't know, and they always ask, I don't know what my why is. Yeah, they have a problem finding their why. It's their why, not mine, but they have a problem. So give a little like a tip for those people, how they can find their why.
Stop losing it.
Because people are really confused, and I just get surprised. And I said, you don't know your why. How long you been trying for? Well, I've been trying for the last 35 years. I said, what?
Ooh.
My gosh, 35 years, you couldn't even find your why, your purpose?
Mm-hmm.
So just give a little, as a leadership guru, I would like you to give some tip.
Okay, no, I'm not a leadership guru. Just
of course you are too. I mean,
so,
yeah.
I feel that it's an important question, because for a lot of people, it has relevance in where they're heading in life. It gives them a sense of belonging and understanding that their journey on this earth is worthwhile and it is meant for something specific. And if they're feeling lost or not knowing their why,
mm-hmm.
it's because they haven't asked themselves the simple questions of what makes them happy, what makes their heart sing, what makes their soul vibrate with happiness.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people say that to find your why, you need to go onto training programs and you need to understand. Mm-hmm. A lot of people go onto these programs where they hope that they find their purpose. And the simplicity of it for me is, what makes you feel brilliant about yourself?
Yeah.
So it could be your ability to listen carefully. It could be the thoughtfulness in the way you help others. It could be in your giving nature. It could be in the way that you will sacrifice everything for everybody, which means that maybe your why is to serve meaningfully. It's as simple as that. And when you understand that that makes you happy and makes your soul sing, that you will go out and go and find places to go and serve people meaningfully. And because that makes you so happy, it doesn't have to be fantastic, amazing things of I'm going to change this world and I'm going to impact millions of people. Maybe you'll impact so many people and the domino effect creates the impact that you want to see and that you deserve to see. See, I feel that a lot of people miss the point because what they're doing is they're looking for an intellectual understanding or intellectual one-line sentence that says, this is my why. My why is very simple. My belief is that I walk this earth and my sole purpose is to touch the lives of every single person I interact with the thoughtfulness of my words, with the kindness in my actions, and with the intention
awesome.
Behind my behavior. And so the simplicity of it allows me to then grow my different programs, grow the different areas of expertise that I use. And it could be through art, it could be through photography, could be through music. But when I do that, I'm embracing what I'm passionate about, and then I'm able to bring joy to other people. So I found my why. And a lot of people are so stuck on wanting they want a professional explanation or a beautiful sentence that's going to say, this is my why. No, the simplicity of it is, what makes your soul sing? And when you can answer that, what are you passionate about? Bring those two together and you will have found your why.
We have such a vast topic and I'm still not at the bottom yet. So, but because the time is running out and I don't want to do too long of a show. So, but still I have curiosity to find out what those three E's and VAK, which you put in your keynote, and as well as those three L's. Can you give us a little brief of those three things? What three E's?
Well, the three E's, it's part of my belief in life, is if we embody the three E's, we can take ourselves onto any journey of self-discovery, self-empowerment, and self-motivation to grow and build our lives into people of influence and people of impact. The first E is embrace your past, because by embracing your past, you acknowledge that whatever happened in your past, the good, the bad, the ugly, every single thing that hurt you and that could have destroyed you, was merely lessons that you needed to learn. And if you kept having that experience, it's because you needed to engage with those lessons until you became strong enough to accept the lessons. And then only could you move on in life. Because I believe that your circumstances does not define your ability to become a person of influence through your actions. Your second E is evaluate. Evaluate your present circumstances. Right now, in your present moments, where do you need to grow and what do you need to develop to take yourself to the next level? And the next level is evolve. Evolve into your future. The future that you deserve is going to be based on the work you do in self-healing, in mindfulness, in understanding your past journey, in letting go, in forgiving people that you needed to forgive, in embracing people in your environment, in letting go of emotional vampires, people that hold you back, people that don't serve you. You need to let go of all of that, and that is by embracing your past, evaluating your present to evolve into your future that you richly deserve.
Awesome. And you said VAK, which is visual, auditory, and kinesthetic. So how this plays a role in leadership?
Oh, this is a brilliant one. And I think for the listeners, it's an amazing tool. If you Google VAK learning styles, You will get amazing, incredible information based on that. Learning styles is part of our cognitive thinking. We're born with three learning styles: visual, audio, kinesthetic. Mm-hmm. But from 7 years onwards, the influences around us develops two more strongly than the third one, which means that visual people take in information through pictures, audio people through listening, through auditory, and kinesthetic people through movement. As leaders, to embody the skill of understanding themselves and where their two strongest points is, allows them to then develop the third side. So a holistic leader who is seeking proper development will embody all three levels of visual, audio, kinesthetic, which allows them to speak clearly, to show people their vision, and to make them feel wanted as human beings. Because kinesthetic people are very emotional and want to feel connection. What I found in corporate companies, the quiet people in the boardrooms are the kinesthetic guys. Mm-hmm. They will sit quietly and listen to everything. They hear everything, they see everything, but they will not speak up because the environment is not safe enough. And then they will be seen as non-communicative people or people who don't step up or are not proactive. The challenge, though, is when they walk out of the room, the boardroom, they've got the most incredible ideas, but they did not engage in that level. And that's where you get gossiping, backbiting, and a whole lot of conflict issues within the organization based on that level. When you have visual people, they speak very quickly and they get an image in the head and they'll only give you tidbits. They'll give you the common sense, straightforward, how are you today? I'm brilliant. Well, you should now use your imagination and work out what brilliant means.
Yeah.
An audio person needs information and wants to feel engaged with. What happens is if you don't understand those three learning styles in your communication, those three can actually have a disconnect. Mm-hmm. That is where a lot of conflict happens across culture. Mm-hmm. And then people say it's because I'm a man or it's because I'm a woman. It's mm-hmm. because of my age. It's because of the color of my skin. No, maybe I felt insulted with the way you spoke to me because we had a disconnect in you keep talking and repeating yourself at me and I don't feel good enough. Mm-hmm. Because I think you're treating me like a child. Mm-hmm. I don't speak up because I don't want to hurt your feelings from the mm-hmm. kinesthetic side. Mm-hmm. A visual person is not listening. A lot of times they've gotten the first piece of your conversation, so they don't have the entirety of the conversation. So you get jobs half done
mm-hmm.
because they need to see things and you're talking too much. There's a disconnect. Mm-hmm. So when you get to understand this as a leader, you can communicate and connect with anybody, anywhere, anytime, regardless of their level in the organization or whether it's a person on the street. Or more powerfully, you can actually engage with your own family. You can save relationships and you can understand why your children are battling in some areas in school and you can help them to develop more powerfully. This is what stops failure rates in schools. It's by understanding this simple technique.
Mm-hmm.
It's what prevents people from leaving organizations. It's a powerful tool.
Yeah, but my question is, like in these kind of situations, like we are going through COVID-19 crisis, so we are basically pulled apart, social distancing mm-hmm. and all that. So everything is now virtual, like we are doing right now this mm-hmm. conversation. So it takes away to me, I mean, the kinesthetic part and visual yes. part. Most of the, because you can't show the whole body language to someone when you're talking to, because we are limited there on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we cannot kinesthetic because we cannot touch people or we cannot touch the stuff which we want to feel it. So how it affects your leadership skill? How you have to overcome on that?
Okay, the best way to overcome is that within these learning styles, it actually teaches you the words you can use to connect with people more meaningfully. So even though you're not physically with people, your choice of words, your tone, the way you express yourself makes a massive difference. So with kinesthetic people, you use words like, I feel like this is the way we should go. I felt encouraged by something you said. I'd love to know more about it. So what you're doing is you're using emotional words to connect to the person. When it's visual people, you say things like, I see what you mean. I get the picture. I now understand where you're heading. How do you see this working? What solutions do you see will fit into our discussion? Or where do you see me going wrong? I'd love your guidance on that.
Mm-hmm.
With an audio person, you use words like, I hear what you're saying. I've understood exactly what you want me to do. I have an idea of the path you're going in. Tell me more about it. So it's the auditory words of say and hear and tell.
Mm-hmm.
So you can engage still in this way without having to physically be with people.
Mm-hmm.
You can still connect on a deep level.
Yeah, but you had to like just focus on that side more, on your like audio part rather than visual. Like you have to use the word hear, heard, and all that. I got it.
But also, I mean, if you think about it, on a lot of the presentations and things, using graphics immediately helps people.
Mm-hmm.
So, using technology more meaningfully. Kinesthetic people love the memes and they love receiving mm-hmm. messages. They enjoy that. So if you're a leader and you want to embody all of this, don't just wait for an online meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Send emails with visuals and motivational updates and audio clips. Record your voice and send it to them
mm-hmm.
on Messenger and all of the different devices you have. Audio people will love that because
mm-hmm.
they're listening to your voice and they're engaging with you in that way. Send the instructions in a graphic and immediately your visual people engage in that way. Send memes and funny things for
mm-hmm.
kinesthetic people. Things that they can print out and look at. I mean, that whole interaction is meaningful for them.
Awesome. And how about those three L's at the end? Like you have the styles of leadership and then three L's to take back your life. Like in your keynote, you said that. So can you tell us those three L's, what they are?
What are my three L's?
Yeah, like a love unconditionally, like you said, number one.
I do. Well, I believe that you've got to lead intentionally
mm-hmm.
and love unconditionally.
Uh-huh.
And when you're connecting with people, it makes a massive difference for them to feel that you connect in a meaningful way. And
mm-hmm.
I just find that being intentional is something that you've got to be aware of every single day. From the moment that you wake up,
mm-hmm.
what intention did you set
mm-hmm.
in your mind of how your day is going to be, how you're going to connect with people, and what is it that you're going to do that'll make somebody else's life easier for you having been in it? When you make that call, what is the opportunity there? And how are you going to best serve the person on that call?
Mm-hmm.
If you are wanting to make a sale, what is the reason behind that?
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to make money or do you want to build a relationship where you know what you're selling adds value to the person?
Mm-hmm.
So when you're leading in that way
mm-hmm.
and you care for people, mm-hmm. you put their lives before yours in mm-hmm. a way where you don't diminish who you are. What you're saying is that I'm stepping up and I want to connect with those human beings on such a high level that when they put the phone down, when they switch off the call, when they're off the business interaction with me online, they must feel, wow,
mm-hmm.
my day is more awesome. I'm more excited about my day now, but just because I had that interaction.
Mm-hmm.
So it's lead more intentionally yourself first.
Mm-hmm.
Before you can interact with anybody else.
Of course, yeah. And that's a key. I mean, obviously, if as a leader, if you can't have an intentional everything, it's not going to happen accidentally. No. So leader,
no.
You have to be intentional. You have to love unconditional. And you have to live intentional, too. So this is all about, okay, awesome. But, I mean, again, you said celebrating your humanness. What is humanness?
Yes.
Can you define humanness?
Your humanness is what makes you the most epic person in this world. The person that walks this earth in your body is the very essence of who you are as a being. And when you think about it, when you honor that person within you and you celebrate your own humanness and you respect yourself, then only can you respect other people and celebrate their humanness. Because when you think about it, we're all born as babies with a clean slate. Then we are taught, oh, by the way, you're a girl or you're a boy. Then you're taught, by the way, this is what we eat in our culture. This is your traditions. This is the religion you follow. These are the schools. These are the people. These are your family. And these are your siblings. You're taught all of that. You did not miraculously come onto this earth with preconceived ideas and notions. And so when you celebrate your humanness, you get back to that point of innocence, of realizing that you have the ability to mold yourself in any way that you can. There's a lot you can unlearn of what you've been taught, relearn the things that adds value to you, that allows you to add value to others, and to learn the things that will help you and guide you to support your journey in that way. When I say celebrate your humanness, you don't walk into a room saying, oh, because I'm a woman and I walked into a room with men, I just know that nobody's going to respect me. It's preconceived ideas, which then encourages gender-based issues. Then it means that when I speak to them, I have disrespect in my interactions because I have got preconceived ideas of what their treatment might be of me. Now, if I walked in a room as a person celebrating my humanness, I can then go into that room and celebrate their humanness. And when I speak, I must speak with compassion and understanding so that when we have an interaction, it's based on our intelligence, our experience, our thoughtfulness. And then we can then support each other and share information more openly. One of the things that I always say to people when it comes to celebrating our humanness is understand this. Give yourself full permission not to like every single person you interact with. As a human being, we'll never ever like every single person we interact with, including within our families, but we still keep them. We can't escape them. So here's the sentence. Give yourself full permission to not like every person you interact with. However, your ability to show respect and be respectful is a direct reflection on your character and dignity as a human being.
Of course.
So at the end of the day, at the level of respect, all people are equal. And so when you are celebrating the humanness of somebody else, it's because you have embodied the understanding, the thoughtfulness, and the acceptance that all people deserve a place on this earth, that all people are human beings and their souls looking for guidance and support. And what can you do in their journey so that other people also add value to your journey? And it's reciprocal.
Awesome. Okay. So because we are running a little bit out of time, but still I'm going to take an opportunity to ask you, can you recommend like a couple books for our viewers they should read?
Yes. Intentional Living, definitely. Okay. Because I find that that will really help to guide people. There's, I think that the next one would be Simon Sinek's of Finding Your Why, because that really adds value in helping you to guide you to your next levels. The other book that I really think is powerful, really powerful, whether you're a stay-at-home mom, a teacher, or a leader or a manager, no matter where you are, even in school, the book is called The Learning Revolution. And it's by Gordon Dryden and Jeanette Voss. She's an Australian-based author, and Gordon Dryden is based in the USA. They're now both based in the USA. But the Learning Revolution will teach you every single thing you need, from the seven intelligences, your learning styles, and every way to stimulate your brain, including speed reading. The book is this thick, but it'll teach you how to read it in 30 minutes.
Wow.
It is stunning, and it's development of the brain from 0 to 60 years old.
Wow.
And then for young, for parents who want to help their children, a book called The First Fundamentals by Colin Rose. just Google Colin Rose and any of his books. He teaches you how to develop your children for with early childhood development. So those are my books that I love.
Wow. Awesome. Awesome. Thank you very much for that. Last but not the least, if it is an opportunity for Aarti to go back 20 years and live again, what you could do different?
Oh, excellent question. I not get married, run away faster overseas, read more, develop more, ask better questions, ask more questions, connect with more people, embrace my passion and never apologize for who I am, and to get rid of feeling guilty that I need to support everybody else at the expense of me.
Mm-hmm.
Though I do not regret the life that I've had, I realize that it's all of the lessons I needed to have in my life in order for me to be sitting here, and for the impact that I can have is only because of the last 20 years of my journey. But to do things differently, I'd ask more questions and question everything.
Yes.
I think that's even more powerful. Don't follow blindly, question every single thing I hear.
Wow. Very powerful. Thank you, Aarti. I think that we are going to need another session with you, and hopefully you are going to give me a little more time, because we are not halfway yet, in my opinion.
You had more questions.
Yeah, we can learn a lot. But anyway, because we have to follow the protocol, and it's almost over an hour now. So I want to thank you very much
for
joining me, and it was an awesome experience for myself. I learned a lot. I took a lot of notes, and hopefully our viewers, they are going to enjoy this whole our talk, and they're going to learn a lot. But hopefully we can join again, at least for the following of this session. All right. So I appreciate your generosity. Thank you very much. And you have a very wonderful this weekend. And also stay safe, healthy, and positive. And my best regards to Anne.
Thank you. I will tell him. Shukran. Right. Okay, bye-bye.